Welcome to the complete story of Final Fantasy XIV, A Realm Reborn. The game that rose from the ashes of Final Fantasy XIV's initially failed launch to become the foundation of the game's later success. In this regard, A Realm Reborn truly lives up to its name, since it breathed new life into a game otherwise destined for the gallows. Nowadays, new players are often encouraged to rush the realm, finishing the game as fast as they can in order to reach the next expansion, since Heavensward is generally considered to take an already good game to the next level. Coupled with the fact that Final Fantasy XIV, on the whole, is fairly text-heavy, and that it's very tempting to skip a lot of it, one would be forgiven for not picking up on the story of A Realm Reborn in its entirety, which is a bit of a shame, since the story is quite engaging on paper, and it lays the groundwork for much of what's to come. Hello, fellow Final Fantasy XIV enthusiasts, I'm Pieter from Birds of Play, and in this video, I hope you'll join me as we revisit the complete story of Final Fantasy XIV, A Realm Reborn. As a little side note, I'm going to be referring to the Warrior of Light in the masculine in the video, just to make things a little bit easier. And because he is generally depicted as a young male Midlander Hjord in the cutscenes for the game. To complicate things a bit, however, my Warrior of Light is nevertheless going to be dressed as a bird. So he's a man in the body of an avian, or something like that. But now, with all of that out of the way, let's return to a time when Final Fantasy XIV was just getting back on its feet. It's going to be a long journey, but I hope you'll be with us every step of the way. As the sun set on the sixth astral era, the Galian Empire launched an all-out assault on the continent of Eorzea. The grand companies of the city-states of Uldar, Gridania, and Limsa-Lominsa banding together to fend off the invading force. Under the influence of mysterious beings known as Asians, the Galians marched on Cardano and waged their bloody war as they cast Meteor, a powerful spell designed to pluck the moon Dalamud out of the sky and drop it down onto the ground below. However, as Dalamud descended, it revealed itself to be no mere moon, but instead a colossal prison, keeping the elder primal Bahamut at bay. Freed from the fetters of its lunar confinement, Bahamut began ravaging the land, forcing sage Luiswa to call upon the power of the gods, the 12, to reseal the primal and to thwart the descent of Dalamud. Laying everything on the line, Luiswa succeeded in halting the primal's rampage, but his valiant efforts tragically cost him his life. Yet, the destruction wrought by Dalamud and Bahamut that had drastically altered the face of Eorzea and left countless dead could not be undone. The events of that fateful day became known as the Calamity and marked the beginning of the Seventh Umbral Era. Five years after the Battle of Cardano, an adventurer destined to become the champion of the Mother Crystal Hydaelyn arrives in one of the city-states of Eorzea, choosing between Uldar, Gridania, or Limsa-Lominsa. By performing many heroic deeds on behalf of the locals there, the adventurer inevitably starts to make a name for himself, and ends up catching the eye of an organization that calls itself the Scions of the Seventh Dawn. The organization shows a particular interest in the adventurer due to him possessing the power of the Echo, a mysterious ability that allows him to catch glimpses of the past and to know the hearts of others. Although the reason for their interest still eludes the adventurer, seeing as their motives are as of yet unexplained. Upon proving himself a true benefactor of the realm, the adventurer is recruited as an envoy to the other city-states by the head of the city-state where he chose to start his journey, the hope being to hold a remembrance ceremony in honor of those who fell at the Battle of Cartano, and to commemorate the alliance between the city-states. In order to fulfill his mission post-haste, the adventurer boards an airship and heads for the next city-state by air. Meanwhile, in another part of the realm, Gaius von Bilesar, the Black Wolf, Legatus of the 14th Legion, arrives with his cohorts in Castrum Meridianum, an imperial outpost positioned at the borders of the Eorzean Alliance. There, he recounts the losses suffered 15 years ago as the Imperial fleet set course for Mordona in an attempt to claim Eorzea, only to be thwarted by an innumerable host of dragons, at the heart of which flew the great Midgard's orbit. Though the Galleons succeeded in slaying the Worm King, it came at a great cost, as the Empire's flagship came crashing down, forcing them to retreat. This time, however, Gaius intends to finish the job, rectifying not only this original insult, but also the bitter defeat the Gallian Empire suffered 5 years ago at the Battle of Cartano. He views his glorious conquest as a form of salvation that will deliver the misguided masses from their ignorance, brought about by their faith in false gods. His officers are of one mind with him and pledge their allegiance to Lord von Bilesar. In the wake of Gaius's arrival, a mysterious object is seen being carried into the Castrum under the cover of darkness. As the adventurer visits the other city-states, they all agree that a memorial service might be just the thing needed to rekindle the spirit of unity, which brought the peoples of Eorzea together when last the Empire threatened their liberty. Having completed his mission, the adventurer is recruited for a new quest by Baderon, the proprietor of the Drowning Wench in Limsa Lominsa, who, along with Commodore Reiner, wants the adventurer to investigate a strange band of men camped out in the Sastasha Sea Grot. Suspecting that they are Serpent River pirates allied with the Sahagin, the adventurer enters Sastasha and slays Den the Orca-Toothed, the Sahagin behind the Alliance. Pleased with his success, Baderon sends the adventurer to Mother Mion at the Carline Canopy in Gradania, who seeks aid in putting down the Lambs of Dalamud, a cult based in the Tamtara Deepcroft that is dedicated to the worship of the lesser moon Dalamud as their god. The party discovers that the Lambs have succeeded in resurrecting the vengeful spirit of Galvanth the Dominator, a long-dead Gelmoran king, whose body has been corrupted by the Lambs of Dalamud to serve as a host to a void-sent mind flayer. The Lambs intend for this unholy abomination to avenge the fall of Dalamud, their god. But the adventurer is quick to dispose of the threat. Having once again proven himself, the adventurer then travels to meet with Momodi at the Adventurer's Guild in Uldar, who sends him to suppress the Hecaton Cherry's revolt in the Copperbell Mines. With the defeat of their leader, Gygus the Great, the Hecaton Cherry's rebellion collapses, and the adventurer returns to Uldar once more. In Uldar, a band of thuggish bodyguards, hired by a merchant, assail a woman, accusing her of stealing meat. The adventurer rescues the damsel in distress, and afterwards, the Echo treats him to a vision that helps him better understand the refugee crisis Uldar faces in the wake of the calamity, as well as showing him that the woman did in fact purchase the meat she had been accused of stealing. Along with the people of Uldar, the adventurer drives the thug away, and afterwards he is approached by a member of the Science of the Seventh Dawn, who has been watching his heroic exploits with great interest. The adventurer is recruited into the Science of the Seventh Dawn, and goes to the Waking Sands to learn more about the organization, meeting Minfilia and Tataru. Minfilia explains that the Scions seek to protect Eorzea from the threat of the Primals, godlike beings summoned by the Beast Tribes in times of crisis. The Scions used the power of the Echo to this end, and it was thanks to the Echo that the adventurer had visions of Hydaelyn and the Battle of Cardano. Suspecting that a robbery and an abduction at Camp Drybone were committed by the Amalja in the name of their primal Ifrit, the Scion Thancred joins with the adventurer to investigate the situation. At Camp Drybone, they find evidence that the Amalja were not acting alone, and it turns out that they recruited the merchant Ungust into their ranks. With the help of a nun, Sister Orsan, Thancred and the adventurer disguise themselves as paupers to lure out Ungust, who is now posing as a priest, giving alms to the poor and converting them to his religion, which of course actually means making them a sacrifice to Ifrit. Thancred and the adventurer capture Ungust and force him to work as a double agent, setting up an ambush to capture the Amalja responsible. However, it is revealed that Ungust was feeding the Amalja information about the ambush, leading the ambush party to be overrun by the Beastmen. The Amalja prepare to sacrifice them all to Ifrit and succeed in summoning him, but the adventurer is able to use the Echo to resist being tempered or enslaved by Ifrit, and is able to slay the Lord of the Inferno in combat. Nero Tall Skyver and Livia Sass Junius, two of Gaius Van Bielsa's top officers, watch events unfold from a safe distance. Nero being simultaneously disappointed with Ifrit's lack of power and impressed with the adventurer's strength, hoping it won't hinder their plans. The adventurer's exploits, especially the victory over Ifrit, earn him the attention of the grand companies who compete for his favor. Remaining undecided, the adventurer goes to watch the Battle of Cardano remembrance ceremonies he helped orchestrate earlier. At the ceremonies, he meets a pair of Alizen twins, Alvino and Alice, who are critical of the attitudes of Merlwhip, Canisena, and Rauban towards the battle, especially the sacrifices of the Warrior of Light and Luiswa. However, the state's leaders do promise further unity within Eorzea to help with the primal and Garlean threats. After watching the ceremonies, the adventurer joins a grand company of his choice. Soon after, an airship is shot down by Garlean forces, and the adventurer joins with the grand company's forces to rescue the surviving engineers, Biggs and Wedge. The airship is revealed to be built by none other than Sid Nan Garland, Biggs and Wedge's former employer, who has been missing since the calamity. Troubled by the Empire's disregard for borders, the adventurer reports back to Minfilia. Minfilia explains that the Sylph tribe is suspected of summoning or attempting to summon Ramu, straining relations with Gridania. The Gridanians, who are already at open war with the Ixal, are incapable of fighting two beast tribes at once. So the adventurer, Ida, and Papalimo embark on a mission to negotiate peace between the Sylphs and the Scions, and thus Gridania. After meeting with Rolf Hawthorne, an ex-adventurer and expert on Sylph etiquette, the Scions arrive in Little Solace, the Sylph community closest to Gridania. Though the Sylph Comuxio is initially suspicious of their intentions, the adventurer is able to endear the Sylphs by defeating Garlean forces, who are camped outside Little Solace, and by rescuing Claxio, who has been captured by tempered Sylphs. Comuxio reveals that the Sylph elder Frixio has gone missing, and the Scions and Gridania agree to arrange a search party. Bruce Caron, a barkeeper who pays attention to such affairs, discovers Garlean forces patrolling the Black Shroud, and after apprehending the twin Adder traitor, providing intelligence for them, Laurentius reveals that Frixio, who is fleeing from Garlean soldiers, has become trapped in the Thousand Maws of Totorak. Deep inside, the adventurous party encounters the Asian Lahabrea, who summons a Bane Mite to test their strength. However, the Bane Mite is slain, and Frixio is rescued. Frixio explains that in the Sylphlands, a faction of Sylphs summoned Ramu to protect themselves from a Garlean invasion. However, Ramu, driven by the fanatic desire to protect his people's homeland, began tempering all of the Sylphs, forcing those that resisted to flee to Little Solace. However, Ramu has instructed his followers to not attack the Gridanians unless they invade the Sylphlands. And neither the tempered Sylphs nor the refugees of Little Solace have any interest in attempting to summon him again. Having ensured peace between the Gridanians and Sylphs, the Scions return to the Waking Sands with the Sylvan diplomat, Norexia. Having suppressed attempts to summon Ifrit and Ramu, the Scions decide to devote time to investigate the return of Lahabrea and the Asians. After research at Highbridge proves fruitless, the adventurer sets his sight on Little Alamigo, home of the Alamigan refugees after their homeland was subjugated by the Garleans, who incited a revolution and then crushed the weakened armies of Alamigo. The Little Alamigan leader, Gundobald, is initially suspicious of the Scions' intentions, but becomes more cooperative when it is discovered that the youth of Little Alamigo met with a masked mage and learned how to summon a primal to fight against the Amalja and eventually take back Alamigo. Gundobald and the adventurer arrive just in time to the Amalja camp to participate in the battle between the Amalja and the youths. Both sides suffer heavy casualties. But once the battle is over, Gundobald is able to dissuade the disenfranchised youths from summoning a primal to fix their lot in life, lest they become tempered wretches, thralls to a god they had looked to for salvation. Disturbed by the violence at Little Alamigo, incited by Lahabrea, Minfilia sends the adventurer on another mission, this one to Falgord Float, where a man named Medrod has reported a sighting of a masked mage. Since the mage's arrival, young maidens have been murdered and their bodies taken by floating eyes to Hawker Manor, where they are used in a rejuvenation ritual for Lady Amandine, a noblewoman who was badly scarred by the calamity. After Amandine is slain and finally put to rest, evidence is found that the Asians were manipulating her. In response to this, Minfilia declares that all nations in Eorzea must bolster their security to protect themselves from Lahabrea and the Asian menace. However, the investigation of the Asians must be put on hold, because the Kobold tribe has succeeded in summoning Titan and plans to use him to assault Limsa Lominsa. Several years prior, Titan had been slain by the Company of Heroes, a mercenary group hired by Limsa Lominsa that has since disbanded. In looking for aid, the Scions are able to track down Weisgeit, a former member of the company, in Costa del Sol. Despite his victory over Ifrit, Ishtola is unable to persuade Weisgeist that the adventurer is capable of defeating Titan, which leads Weisgeist to test the adventurer by sending him on a series of increasingly dangerous missions to obtain foodstuffs for a banquet for his master, the wealthy owner of Costa del Sol, Kegeruju. After the completion of Weisgeist's trials, the adventurer is awarded by access to Titan's lair. The adventurer's party slays Titan, and Ishtola discovers that La Habrea was watching the battle. Ishtola remains in Limsolominsa to investigate, while the adventurer returns to the Waking Sands, only to find the corpses of countless Cylons. A dying Noraxia reveals that the Galleons conducted a raid in search for the slayer of Ifrit, and took Menphilia and the other leaders hostage. Menphilia's last words before being captured were an order to Noraxia to ensure the adventurer took refuge at the Church of St. Adama Landama. Heeding Menphilia's request, the adventurer goes to the church, where he meets a distraught veteran of the Battle of Cartano named Marquez. After the members of the church tend to the burial of the dead Scions, Alfino arrives and claims that he will resurrect the organization because the city-states are too incompetent and plagued with internal problems to fend off the beast tribes, let alone the Galleons, and that the situation is urgent since the Ixal have already succeeded in summoning their primal Garuda. To this end, Alfino uncovers Marquez as the great airship engineer Sid Nan Garland, who built the Enterprise, which went missing over Coethus shortly before the Battle of Cartano. This revelation is news even to Sid himself, who had forgotten his true identity in the wake of the calamity. Together, Sid, Alfino, and the adventurer resolve to recover the Enterprise, rescue the captured Scions, and defeat Garuda. Upon arrival in Coethus, they are met with hostility by the Ishgardian nobility, who are fully dedicated to the Dragon Song War and show no interest in the secular conflicts of the Eorzean Alliance. However, by rescuing several Ishgardian troops and apprehending a false inquisitor named Guillaume, the adventurer earns the trust of Lord Drillmont, who allows access to the Stone Vigil, where the Enterprise has been found. In the process, the adventurer also befriends Horchefort Greystone of House Fortomp, who presides over Camp Dragonhead in the Coethus Central Highlands. When it comes to actually braving the Stone Vigil to retrieve the Enterprise, Ishgard offers no assistance, meaning the adventurer must fight through it himself along with his party, slay the Dravanian Horde, and defeat the dragon Iskabind to recover the airship. During the prior battles between the Ishgardians and Dravanians for the Vigil, the Enterprise was damaged, so even after they retrieve it, Sid still requires a corrupted crystal to fix it. After false starts in Camp Drybone and the Isle of Umbra, the adventurer is finally able to procure one by slaying a Spriggan named Giggity with the aid of the Sylphs. After the airship is repaired, Sid takes the wheel and recalls his memories from before Meteor Fall. He thanks the Warrior of Light for helping him recover the missing pieces of his past. Diving into the Howling Eye, the adventurer does battle with the Garuda, the Lady of the Vortex. Garuda is eventually defeated, but not slain by the party. She is swiftly rejuvenated by the devotion of the Ixal. However, after her failure to temper the party, a mysterious force strikes her down, and Gaius von Bielsaar, Imperial Legatus, arrives and taunts her. Garuda tortures kobolds and a Malja that she has taken hostage, causing them to despair and summon Titan and Ifrit. It is at this time that Gaius unleashes an ancient Alagon armor known as the Ultima Weapon, which devours all three primals, seemingly effortlessly, absorbing them into its mechanism. The crew of the Enterprise returns to the Waking Sands to meet with Ishtola, who agrees that they must break into Custom Sentry to rescue the Scions. They are able to track down Biggs and Wedge, who hijacked an airship flight out of Custom Sentry and escaped to Coethus. They encounter an adventurer in Revenant's Toll named Glomont, who has a personal grudge against the Empire, and aids the group in their attempt to steal a Magitek armor from Custom Sentry. Having procured an armor, the adventurer, Sid, Biggs, and Wedge sneak into Custom Sentry and break out Minfilia and the other Scions. They also discover that Thancred was possessed by Lahabrea and used as a pawn in his manipulations of the Beast Tribes. After their escape, they see an airship with Gaius inside. He announces an ultimatum: that Eorzea surrender to the Empire or be annihilated by the Ultima Weapon. The leaders of the Eorzean Alliance draw up their terms of their surrender, unwilling to waste further lives for a hopeless cause. Merlwib in particular speculates that a Galian presence may prevent further summonings of primals, which, without the Scions of the Seventh Dawn, Eorzea is helpless against. However, thanks to the timely arrival of Alfino, Minfilia, and Sid, the Alliance destroys their terms of surrender and declares war on Garlemald. The Alliance develops a plan of counterattack that will culminate in the destruction of the Ultima Weapon, Operation Archon. The operation hinges on the ability of the Alliance to isolate Castrum Meridianum, where the weapon is held, from other Imperial strongholds. First, when Prefectus Irritatin Serservina travels from Castrum Occidens to Cape Westwind for an inspection, he will be assassinated by the adventurer's party. As Ritatin is a genius field tactician, his death is expected to throw Cape Westwind and Castrum Occidens into disarray. Second, Castrum Meridianum will be cut off from its supply lines, as the Maelstrom's forces besieges Castrum Occidens and Castrum Marinum, and the Order of the Twin Adder, aided by the Sylphs, attack Castrum Oriens. Third, Castrum Meridianum will be breached as the Order of the Twin Adder destroys the rail lines connecting Castrum Sentry and Castrum Meridianum, and the adventurer's party disables the Magitek field generator inside Meridianum, protecting the Praetorium, the research laboratory, where the Ultima Weapon is housed. Finally, the Immortal Flames will begin an all-out assault on the Castrum, allowing the adventurers to raid the Praetorium and destroy the Ultima Weapon. Along with the Grand Companies and the Scions, many free companies and even beast tribes prepare for war. As soon as word arrives of Ritatin's inspection, the party sneaks into Cape Westwind and strikes him down. Joined by Sid, they continue into Castrum Meridianum, where they take control of Magitek cannons and fire them on defending Galian forces. After blowing up the first two field generators, they fire on an aerial craft, which crashes into the third, leaving the Praetorium's defenses open. Tribunus Olivia Sass Junius faces the party operating a Magitek armor, but eventually discards the machine and fights the party on the ground, using her gunback nux. She is defeated and left to die as she cries out for her lord. The party enters the Praetorium and arrive at the laboratory of Tribunus Nerotol Skyver, who believes that by slaying the adventurer, he can infuse the Ultima weapon with the Echo, thus surpassing even Cid in genius. After being defeated, Nero flees. Meanwhile, Castrum Occidens and Castrum Sentry fall to the Alliance, and Maelstrom and Twin Adder forces begin firing on Castrum Meridianum. Deep within the Praetorium, the party confronts Gaius. Upon defeat, he boards the Ultima weapon, who channels the power of the consumed primals against the party. Hydaelyn's power protects the party from Ultima weapon, but La Habrea breaks through this by unleashing Ultima, a spell that destroys the Praetorium. La Habrea plans to use the devastation to unleash the one true god. But with the power of the Blessing of Light, however, he is banished from Thancred's body, and the adventurer escapes from the Castrum with a scion in tow. The Alliance leaders meet on the shore of Lake Silvertear in Mordona and declare the coming of the seventh astral era, thereby proclaiming the rebirth of the realm. However, during the festivities, the Echo treats the Warrior of Light to a vision of a dark crystal, seemingly the opposite of the Mother Crystal. As he regains his senses, they hear the roar of a recently summoned primal in the distance, which serves as a reminder that they haven't truly entered an age of peace. In a dark room, a group of Asians gather, noting the stirring of the elder primal Bahamut, before joining in praise of their one true god, Zodiac. And thus did dawn break on a realm reborn. But where there is light, there is always shadow. Hey everyone, thanks for watching. If you liked the video, get ready for more, since we're already hard at work on the next one. While you wait, you can also check out our video for the complete story of the Binding Coil of Bahamut. Make sure to subscribe for some more Final Fantasy content, and don't forget to peck that like button with your beak, because we're birds. Until next time, caw-caw!